Good morning to all of you. I was trained as a medical doctor. And as a medical doctor, you learn how to deal with emergencies. Two cars crash, casualties, broken bones, blood. If you follow some of the TV series on hospitals, you might believe 90% of the work of doctors is emergencies. The other 10% being gossiping and chasing the nurses and doing all the fun stuff at the hospital. When I finished my medical training and I was in medical practice, I found very little emergencies. What I found was mostly older people with all sorts of complaints, often combined, complex health issues. And there was one day that I realized that these are emergencies too. They are just as deadly. A heart attack is just as deadly as two cars crashing. The only thing that is different is that two cars crashing happens in 20 seconds and a heart attack happens in 20 years. It's like two cars going towards each other in 20 years. And what frustrated me was that these people will always come into my consultation room just after the crash. I say, oh, doctor, pain on my chest, and then I would diagnose a heart attack, send him to the hospital, and I had the feeling that I was always just too late. And with 20 years, you have a lot of time to steer away. So I wanted to understand the aging process better, the process that gets you during those 20 years towards that emergency, the emergency in slow motion. Your heart attack, diabetes, other diseases of old age. So I went into research, and I did my PhD research on aging. And for this research, I went to Africa. I went to Ghana, to the countryside, to a region where there are no hospitals, there are no medical doctors. I wanted to understand how people age in this environment. In a maybe more natural environment. Now, you might think that if you want to understand aging, why do you go to Africa? People don't live long in Africa. Maybe life expectancy is 40, 50 years. But that's because there's high child mortality. That's what keeps the average low. But there are many people who do live to their 70s and 80s. And if you study these people, you find that they age completely different. They have problems too, infectious diseases, malaria. But the diseases that I saw every day in my medical practice here in the Netherlands, cardiovascular disease, diabetes, they were virtually non-existent. They happened only maybe after 80 years, 20 years later than I would see them here. So maybe we can learn something from these old people in Africa. Because people always ask me, so what is their secret? Do they have special berries that they eat? Do they dig up certain roots? What's this holy grail of longevity and youth that they have? Well, the answer is always a little bit disappointing because you know what they have? They have a healthy lifestyle. They're farmers, they exercise all day, they have a healthy diet, they don't have high-calorie soft drinks and all sorts of fatty and sugary foods. And you all know that. For 30 years, you've been told that lifestyle is important. You've been told to eat less salt, eat less sugar, eat more vegetables, exercise more. It's not very fun. At least I never liked it when people tell me what to do. And if you think about it, did it really help us that they told us what to do? In the past 30 years, did we become healthier? Did we develop healthier lifestyles? No. 30 years ago, 1/3 of the Netherlands was overweight. Now half of our population is overweight. We have 1 million people with diabetes, which is estimated to grow even further. Enough to keep the doctors busy. What I learned in Africa was not that lifestyle is the key to healthy aging. I know examples of that in the Netherlands too. Did you know that the richest 20% of the Netherlands, that they outlive the poorest 20% by 7 years? And the Netherlands is considered to be one of the most egalitarian societies. Not only do they live 7 years longer, the richest 20% lives 19 more years in good health compared to the poorest 20%. How do they do it? With the money, can they go to better doctors? Can they go to better hospitals? No. Healthcare is very accessible. The only difference is that they have a different lifestyle, a different routine of during the day, a different environment that they live in. 7 more years of life, 19 more years of healthy life. That's what's to be gained. And what I learned in Africa, I did not find healthy individuals, not a healthy 20%, I found a healthy community. Because of the over 1,000 old people that we did all these medical investigations, we made recordings of the heart, ultrasound of the arteries, blood research, and none of them had diabetes. So all of them were healthier. There were no healthy individuals, it was a healthy community. And that proved to be the key. And we should stop, we should let go of telling people what to do. Telling people what to eat, how to move, go to the gym 3 evenings a week. We should also stop shaming and blaming the sick for being sick. Telling them it's your own fault. With your lifestyle, you could have been healthy, but now you're sick. I don't believe that. If my patients that I saw were born in Ghana, they would have aged completely different. Not because they themselves were different, because the environment there is different. And what I learned is that it's the environment that drives the aging process, that drives disease, that makes you sick. Our bodies have evolved in an environment that's much more like the African environment, an environment with scarce resources. Our body is programmed to harvest calories as much as possible, to store it in fat, and to hold on to these calories, not to spend it with needless exercise. Our bodies are frugal. They had to be to survive. But in our modern environment, we have banned all exercise. We have made roads, and railways, trains, cars to transport goods and ourselves. We have escalators, we have appliances at home to do our washing, our dishes, everything, vacuuming. One of my friends, he even has a pepper mill, which is an electric pepper mill. If you want pepper on your meal, you press a button. It will also shine light on your meal to no use at all. We have banned all activity from our daily lives. At the same time, we've built rooms in every city where people go at the end of the day to run on a running band without progressing 1 meter to get the daily exercise that they first abandoned from their life. And it's a little bit strange, really. And at the same time that we've abandoned exercise, we have never had such an abundance of food in our environment. If you go to the supermarket and you see all the calories around you, you visit conferences, or even this morning when I came here by train, and at the station people try to give me all certain products for free to eat, to try, to tempt me, to lure me into consuming more. So it's not our fault. Our bodies are misused. Our ancient settings, our ancient genes, They don't fit this environment. That we have receptors on our tongue to detect sugar, and that they are wired to the brain so that if you eat sugar, you're happy. It feels nice. That's a design to survive our old environment. But this design makes us sick in this environment. So if our body, our design, our genes do not fit this environment, there are two solutions. Either you change the design, but that's technically not possible. We cannot re-engineer ourselves so that broccoli makes us go wild and that we detest sugar and fat. If the problem is that our genes do not fit the environment, we cannot change the genes, we have to change the environment. Not so long ago, I was on the plane, flying to Budapest, and I was flying KLM, and they still feed you midair. And I got a tray, and one quarter of the tray was used for the dessert, which was white chocolate mousse. At least it was very sweet, and it was very tasty. And I found myself, with the small spoon they provided, scraping the last remains out of this container. And then it struck me that, who decides how much of this stuff I'm actually eating? If they had put in 10% more, I would have eaten 10% more. Had they put in 10% less, I would have eaten 10% less. I had already accepted that KLM decides what I eat, when I eat, but now I realized they also decide how much of it I eat, and I was not comfortable with that. Now, the good news is that at home, you control your own serving sizes. There's an American cookbook, it's called The Joy of Cooking. It exists for over 100 years now, I believe. And they have studied all the different issues, and they have seen that the same traditional American dishes for four persons, the portion sizes increase every 10 decades. And so did the American people after that. If you look at the size of the plates these days, they're much larger than the plates of our grandparents. If you look at the size of our wine glasses these days, do you still remember that you could still pour six good glasses out of a bottle of wine? Well, nowadays you can almost empty a full bottle in two glasses and it doesn't even look funny. Now, does this matter? There are now over 60 studies that show that the size of portions, of glasses, of spoons, of soup bowls, determine the amount of calories you eat. You don't eat until you have enough, until you're satisfied. You eat until you finish your plate. And there are some beautiful experiments with which they have tested this. I think you know them. These are soup bowls glued to the table with a little rubber tube. And then the researchers can fill the... and make you eat twice as much without you noticing. And if you ask these people afterwards, they didn't notice, and they feel equally satisfied. You don't eat until you're satisfied, you eat until you finish your bowl. Now, half of our Dutch people are overweight. And that's why diet books, they sell so well. You know, diets work great. Right? For 6 weeks. And you lose 6 kilos. But it doesn't matter which one you follow. You can eat less carbohydrate, less protein, less fat, less sugar, less pizza, less chocolate. You should eat less of something at least, but then you lose weight. But they've also studied this and looked at the long-term follow-up after 1 year. And then they realized that after 1 year, 95% of the people on diets are back to their original weight, plus the extra half kilo that you gain every year. So diets are a classical example of telling you what to do. Don't eat this, don't eat that. You're trying to, with your brain, to control your body in doing something that it doesn't want. So every day, you look at the chocolate, and you tell the body, don't eat the chocolate. And it's not very fun, and it doesn't work. Let go. Instead, if you want to lose weight, buy smaller dishes. Does that really work? Yes, they've done that. They've replaced the dishes in families' homes, came back after 1 year, all family members had lost weight. Okay, Instead of trying to change our conscious health behaviors, going to the gym 3 times a week, eating differently, we should look at our unconscious health behavior, the things we do every day, which we don't even think about it. You are all sitting here. When you came into the room, did you think, what are my options today? Shall I sit or shall I stand? No. What is the reason that you are now sitting? The reason you are now sitting is because there are chairs. Because of the design of this room. And a little bit of culture of how we do things. Yeah. But you can change this. At your work, you can, instead of having desks where you sit all day, you know that sitting is bad for you. There's another speaker also today talking a lot about it. Sitting is the new smoking, sitting is too inactive. We're not made to sit all day. And if you equip your office with desks that you can raise so that you can also stand, or maybe in your canteen, where you go for lunch, why sit again? Why not stand at a small table? You can become a little bit more active. And if you develop this into the new routine, you won't even think about it. It's just your new habit of how you do things. In my office, I have such a table now, and now I work standing, but I don't even think about it. The same thing is that we put up these bowls with apples. Now, nobody tells me that I should, David, eat more apples. But since they have put the bowl with apples there, I eat more apples. It's a little bit scary, maybe, but that's how they control me, but in a good way, luckily. With smart, small changes in the environment in which you are daily, your kitchen, where your plates are, at home, at school, at work, you can make healthier options just a little bit easier, more fun. Scientists call that nudging. So you nudge a little bit, you give a small push into the right direction. And because this push comes back every day, it has a long-term effect, has large impact. Now, there are things you can do yourself, but there are also environments that you cannot influence yourself. But if you look at it, we have created all these environments together. We have built these rooms, we have built these chairs, we built these cities. I want to talk about one city, and that's Copenhagen. And in Copenhagen, they wanted the people to cycle more, to use the bike more often. And they chose this option. They did not tell people you should bike more. They made biking more fun, easier, faster, more accessible. They have a green wave so that you can cycle for 6 kilometers into the city center without having to stop once. All the lights are green for you. We have that for cars in the Netherlands. If you've ever parked your bike in Amsterdam and you didn't store it in the proper position, people will come, they will break your lock, they will take your bike, export it to a place far away from the city center, and then somewhere between 3 o'clock at night and 5 in the morning, you can get it back if you pay a $60 fine. In Copenhagen, they have the same issue. A lot of people ride bikes. If they find a bike store not in the proper position, they have bike butlers. And bike butlers, they put your bike in the right position for you. Also, they will check your tire pressure, grease your chain, check the lighting on your bike, and they will leave a tag on the bike. And the tag says, "Thank you so much. That's great. You are contributing to making Copenhagen the cycle city of the world. Please, would you be so kind to park your bike into the..." And that works. So they make biking fun. They make it easy. They make it fast. And they have surpassed Amsterdam now in terms of biking. This is an example of how you can make people bike. There are many examples of how you can make people eat healthier, sleep better, be more social. The environment is so crucial in this. Together, we have created this environment that makes us sick. And in 20 years, the two cars will collide, an emergency in slow motion, and we'll all end up at the consultation room of our GP with pain in the chest, diabetes, and all the age-related diseases. Together, we can change this. Together, we can reshape our environment. And I want you to start with your own environment, at your home, and others will benefit from it too. At home, your children, your family members will benefit from the new plates, from the new rearrangement of your refrigerator, from whatever all the changes you make. At work, your colleagues will benefit. At school, the other children, in the neighborhood, your neighbors. And if we all do this, all these environments will connect to create a health zone in which we all live to 80 without the diseases that we now suffer from. And we'll have a healthy community just as the people that I saw in Ghana. Together we can do this. Together we can change it. Together we can reshape it. And together we can prevent the emergency in slow motion from colliding. Thank you very much.